want to thank everybody for joining us today. For those who've been in the jury, this is day one of a two-day event that we do, which we call our phase two final thesis reviews in the DRL. For people that are joining us today, we are, I think, sometimes in a privileged position to be in a place where our graduates can kind of come back to us and sit at this podium and give this keynote lecture. And I can say that specifically, not only, I guess, because I was one of them, but the last 3 years, anyway, we've had one of our lectures given by one of our graduates. 2 years ago, it was Rob. Last year, it was Sajay. And in the same generation as Sajay, which for me, to be honest, was a kind of critical moment for me, which was the moment that I became a studio tutor with Vasilis in 2004 to teach my very first studio. And having Sajay as a student and being part of a group of people under the guidance of Brett and Patrick and Tom and others who were here, me and Vasily set up a studio. We had a lot of things, but we felt a very strong kinship, I think, to a lot of the people that came out of the generation. So Sajay, Malike, Alif is here, people like Daniel Vidrig and others who were part of a group, Britta, and the list kind of goes on. Dao Day, whose work is also on show down the street, where we have, it's not a DRL 20th anniversary show, but it's the first show of more shows to come where we're trying to consolidate basically what we've done as a project for 20 years. So in a very strange way, I keep feeling a deep nostalgia as these years go on, mostly because I'm reminded of how many years I am also part of this, where I came as a student in 99. And like a lot of things, I think, and maybe Malike would agree with me, we don't have many moments of self-reflection when you come back to a place where you actually came really with an amazing admiration for the things that have happened within the walls of what was called and is the Architectural Association. And it's a place that I think, and I want to believe, is still one of the only places, one of the few places, where architecture with a capital A in as expanded of a definition of what that could be has a home. And I say that because I think, you know, in a very straightforward way, the DRL has had a home in this place, and it continues to sort of put forward an unapologetic belief that design is not only important, it's fundamental in all aspects. From discourse, how one conceptualizes the notion of space, from the tools that we're sort of discovering, to the tools that we try to create ourselves to sort of move this project forward. It's part of a community. I say part of it because I think it's one community of many here, but I think it's a community that has, I think, very much profited from young people coming to help us shape the agendas that we're basically putting forward. We work on 3 or 4 year cycles. We work in a way which is very speculative. We have challenges, disagreements. It's like a bit of a family situation where we love and hate each other at the same time. And at the same time, problematizing where architecture is, where it can go, and how we can get there. And I think realistically speaking, as a keynote, I'm very, very happy that Malike is joining us tonight. I think she embodies a lot of the things that actually we feel is really important. And one of that is the belief that this is the beginning of something. It's not a finality. We have an end of, let's call it, cycle presentation where we present a thesis work, but actually this is motivated not even explicitly by the work that's generated here, but really an approach to how one thinks about design, and in particular in our world, design research, and how that's a stepping stone into a world where practice and thinking and discourse and the context in which you operate are all part of that kind of expanded idea of what our community is. It is a very strange presentation for me because I made a presentation here last year with certain thoughts in mind, and that hasn't really changed. And for tonight, anyway, I introduce Malike as a friend. So no bios from my side, but other than the fact that 15 years ago, she came and presented. 15 years ago, she sat as a phase one looking at work like this. And 15 years later, she comes here. 10 years ago was the first time that I was called the director of some sort of this program. The nostalgia keeps kind of going down the line, and I'm gonna stop, because you don't need to see a grown man cry. I'm not gonna cry, it's not my style. But saying that, I really want to warmly welcome Malike. She set up her office, and she's going to basically tell you a little bit about her journey. And I'm very happy that there are a lot of people here outside of the DRL that's potentially not Turkish and know that she's already a celebrity. Celebrity back in Turkey, but she should be a celebrity pretty much everywhere. And as a young female architect setting up her own practice and doing her thing, I think that that is not only amazing, but it's a sign of things to come. And I think she'll give us a window into how she did it and does it, and will continue to do that as part of our family. So please warmly welcome Malike.
Thank you, Tia, for this amazing introduction. And I'm really honored to be here tonight and to share with you actually my journey for last 15 years, actually 20 years since actually the way how I entered into the architectural world. It was around 1999, like beginning of, at the end of 19s. And afterwards, almost for 20 years, things developed in my life in a always positive way. And actually, I will start today sharing my journey, but mainly my focus today will be present one of our recent work in my practice. It's Istanbul TV and Radio Tower. But before that, it's, I believe that it's really important since today was the jury day for AADRL, and I was one of these students, as you said, 15 years ago. And for you to share two journeys, I believe, really important. And there are four important doors, actually, in my architectural career. One of them is this building. This is Istanbul Technical University. This was the first door for me which opened the architectural world. And it was really important because this was a fantastic building, like as a historical building. And there, meeting amazing people and, you know, visionary people, they really led me in 2004 to London to come to AA and to become part of this family, architectural association family. I remember like really entering this store and sitting like you in this here and really imagining the future, how things, I was so at the same time anxious, excited, scared, everything together. But one of the most important things, I believe, what AA is about, this institution gives you the opportunity really learn how to learn, discover, research, and really be innovative in your ideas and really push the boundaries further. If you believe in them, you can do any of this. And I want to show you some familiar faces just 15 years ago. As you can notice, Theo, Sarge, and on the back there is Elif. And now all of them are doing really great in this for this AA family and for the development of architecture and research. And I look quite slim there, but you know, in 20 years you also gain. And afterwards, I would like to mention to you actually shortly about our DRL, my DRL experience. Actually, these people, Daniel Widrick, Samar Shemun, and me, we teamed up back then. And these people have been quite important role in my also design research world, because we our research project was for us really a challenging thing, and Patrick took our studio, so we developed a lot of things that, and today, the way how I see some, you know, that research continues, it was quite interesting for me. First things, shortly, what I would like to mention, I'm not going to go into detail about the research project, but just I want to really take some important things. One of the first important things for us really was to question the organizational system of the Cartesian, like to really think about all the degrees between 0 and 90, how we can really do this. And back then, the digital and computational things were developing, but they were not as, you know, further developed like today. We were taking our research from the analog machines, which were really developed by Fraiotto's experimentations. We discovered a lot of things from there. We learned a lot. And then we were trying to apply them through the digital computational stuff using, let's say, for us, the Maya was one of the most important softwares, and we were trying to misuse it, like, because it was not for architecture, it was for actually film sector and movie and animation stuff. And besides that, like all these things, like during this 16 months, actually for me, this diagram has been always very important. I mean, normally this is a dynamic diagram because we were using hairs and trying to implement hairs as a structural system. It was really, in a way, so imaginary things, but we could make it happen, like, because we were thinking like to make optimized systems, network systems and stuff. And these five things has been, since 15 years, my five important key words, in a way. Cultural exchange, teamwork. Teamwork was the key point, and it has been, and it will be always. Research and design, like these are things that you cannot really separate from our practices. And parametric tools, like they don't need to be named parametric, but the tools, like the digital computation, all the tools that you use. And the most important part is actually what AA gave us and the Design Research Laboratory was to think about, I mean, to learn how to think about complexity. Like, as you develop this way of understanding, you can deal with many things. And here, I want to show you, like, this was one of our important and key, in my opinion, diagrams, because this was a, there are also very important keywords in this diagram, in my opinion, to really create space in an organizational system, like self-organized. You have units, like how they really communicate to each other, how do they create an organization through chaos and all these things. And this lead us into, in our project, in a way, we try to manage to take all this information into a structural level, and we develop certain tectonics and structural studies and digital fabrication. Back then, digital fabrication for me and for us mainly was something new. I mean, there was only laser cutter here and one CNC machine, not even a 3D printer and laser cutter. I remember I was coming, it was as small as this one maybe. I was standing like 2 hours in front of it, watching like it's cutting something. And but anyhow, this was on the left side. You see our, for us it was our first 3D print model. It was so expensive, and back then it was, of course, really important to have a 3D print model. But today technology developed in a really efficient way, economically also. So everyone can really have it. And on the right side you see our first CNC stuff and molding and really thinking about positive modeling, negative modeling, the structure, the nodes, the like many things. Like you start really developing the layers of thinking how to this kind of architecture can really have certain solutions in its structure, because this project was mainly, it was called Urban Lobby, and it was really related about creating space through optimized path systems and developing this into architecture and creating a structure in a way that you can really be inside the structure, on the structure, under the structure, like many things. And at the end, our master project, this urban, because our team was called MRGD, and this master project was published, and back then Patrick and Theo also wrote the introductions for this project in this book, and Le Biusut was the editor of the book. I mean, these things for us was really important, because these were really key things to really start. And I remember, if I'm not wrong, it was maybe one of the first times that you start mentioning about parametricism, maybe in this article, if I'm not mistaken. And of course, this research project opened us a new door, and on my team, we were hired by you, and we start working. We start working at Zaha Hadid Architects, and I mean, many of you may know or may not know. I don't know. There are these girls' entrance and boy entrance, and for almost 7 years, I was going through that girls' entrance, and it was for me, it was a fantastic world, because it was the center of knowledge and sharing and learning, and you are really in the center of this, because everyone comes here, even the developers for technology and stuff, they were testing on us their softwares and these kind of things. Anyway, I worked, my first project was this Istanbul, there was a master plan competition. Exactly in 2006 March, I started working at ZHC, and they were nominated, they were invited to compete in this competition in Istanbul. And it was my second day in the office, and you arranged a design charrette back then. And because it was my first professional, how do you say, experience in an office environment. And there in this design charrette, they set up 10 teams. Each of them has two people, one senior and one junior. And I was freshly, of course, graduated from this design research lab. And so we had to come up with an idea. And I thought to take this optimized path system on a master plan level, to really also develop this research in a further level, could be really interesting agenda to also test in this competition. And so we start really, this was a 24-hour design charrette. I proposed this diagram because this was a hair dynamics diagram which ran, I mean, through certain computations in the software. And then we came up with this, and we were discussing through Patrick and Zaha. And at the end, anyway, the project developed. And Zaha won the competition. So after this, almost 7 years, I worked more than 25 projects. Only three of them are built, and some of them were on hold, and endless competitions, and all of them were, I mean, all over the world, because they have this opportunity to give also us, you know, to experience this amazing world. And I worked maybe more than 300 people, but I met thousands of people, because they were passing by, and you know, some of them stay 1 year, some of them stay even longer than me there. But these four, again, like keywords were really important for architecture. architecture practice, actually, and also the design world, design, coordination, collaboration, construction, like this path, in a way, I think I learned through these 7 years how these things should be organized and how they things can come together, because it's a complex process, it's not something simple. And my last project was in China. It was another computation project. It happened, I think, late 2011. We won it, and directly they started. And recently, you opened the project. Yeah, I saw the pictures. At the end of 2000, I mean, it was a 400,000 square meter mixed-use project with two high-rise. One of them is hotel and stuff, and on the ground there was almost 100, if I'm not mistaken, 120,000 square meter conference center. So this was a really crazy time in traveling a lot and also learning the Chinese way of thinking, like they are totally different. And these were the people that, because we were working so much, I mean, in general, during 7 years, it was crazy, but this poster, like my teammate back then, Xiaowei, he prepared this because we were really, because since you, if you work in China, in the other side of the world, you don't only work 24 hours, like you, it's like not, shifts are overlapping constantly, so we didn't have plan, backup, or choice. We had to just make it happen, so we managed. And yeah, it was a joke between us, but for me, it was really important poster, like to say, if we made this happen, then we can do anything happen. So at the end of 2012, I decided, because it was in my career, it was a point, either I was going to stay all my life there, because I didn't even think another option, because for me, Zaha Hadid Architects was really the place, or I was going to really take the risk and start from zero. And it was such a risk, like it's not something easy, because there everything's perfect. People are amazing, you have all the smart people around you, and but somehow Istanbul called me, so I need to, I had to go away. It was, I couldn't say no, so so I took the decision. It was hard because I didn't want to leave, but in a way I had to take the decision, so I decided. Then this door opened for me. This is my office is on the inside this building on the fifth floor. So I go every day through that little door into my office. And we are around 10, 12 people. It changes according to the project sizes. And we work on different scale of projects. One of the most important projects, which I will also present today, is this Istanbul TV and Radio Tower project. This was a competition project. And besides that, we do also cultural centers, office building, and we do international competitions, national competitions. I'm just showing you kind of the portfolio of our projects. We do also research projects regarding concrete art, concrete research-related projects. This was a summer school last year, again from that project, like trying to play with materials and stuff. This was another project for a biennale in Turkey, in Antalya. It was called Motion in the Shell. This is our meeting table in our office. So we also tried to design in furniture scale, at least experimented. And before I dive into Istanbul Çamlıca and TV Tower project, I would like to shortly, really shortly, briefly, to say some words about how I think about the relation, the dialogue between nature, technology, and architecture, because it also, you will see some things in our projects related to this. Also today, in these jury reviews, they were mentioning a lot of things, I mean, related to future. But what I believe and what I see is actually we are living in a transition period in architectural era. The mass production period is ending and the real mass customization era is starting. And all these researchers, I mean, since 15 years, what you are also developing, they will happen soon and they will start happening. And for that, we all need to really find answers. I mean, first we need to really find the right questions and then to find try to find the answers for complex problems of tomorrow. And for this, I don't think there is only black and white, zero and one, yes or no. There are all kind of grays and all these opportunities we need to discover. It's a gradient. The future is like this. And in this world, that's why we need to really be front with technological things, because they will become our tools to really see all the opportunities and find the right solutions for the certain problems. And the nature, I mean, how to look at the nature, the way how I believe we should look at it, and many researchers and people that I follow, and I would like to also, if there are opportunities, take part in my projects, are here you see the dragon blood tree from Socotra Island in Yemen, and this is around 600 years old, and there are many things existing in the world that we can learn from them, like not only the way how they look, the way actually how they are structured from macro scale to micro scale, and the way how they live, the way how they really, you know, inhabit other living organism inside them. And yeah, from micro scale, when you look at them, you start to really see different organizational systems, and you really try to understand how these things really develop in time. And they are not static, they are alive, like they are changing, they are adapting. And we need to learn and develop how to talk with technology, because if, I mean, AA is really the source of this, like, because when I teach and talk in Turkey, it's a different thing, because I need to, because here, I am from here, from this way of vision and background, but there, I need to really talk about this differently to really open them to opportunities of these things, what you were discussing today, because if not, people, they will become, in my opinion, the slave of the technology instead of the ones who are running them and who are leading them. And all these pretty images that, you know, showing you, let's say, different projects we were working on or back then at MAA or at Zaha Hadid Architects. Actually, this is the screen what I am interested in, because this is the, here you see a kind of overlapping diagram between the tools that we are using. I mean, you need to, sometimes you need to program certain things. You need to use certain logic of technological softwares or tools to be able to really generate things. And BIM thing, like building information modeling thing, is for me as a platform to really make the design, as I was showing, like design, collaboration, coordination, and construction. Like if you want to really complete this cycle, you need to have this kind of platforms, and the tools that you are using are your best friends, actually, if you want. And some of my best friends, and every time this is changing, like this thing, like these guys are daily base, we are using them, and you know, they are part of you, like the way how you wear your clothes, actually you are opening these softwares and they are becoming part of your thinking, and you are thinking through them sometimes to develop certain understanding related to geometry, mass, sustainability, the environment, whatever, you know, your research subject is. But especially the way how I am also interested, because I am educated that way at AA and at Zaha Architects, from form, geometry, to constructible solutions, there is this really important path, and the way how you fit this path is really important if you want to make the design you show on the renders and stuff, make it real, like make it really happen, you need this path. I mean, these things, there are many advanced ways of using them, but today they are available in our offices. Like you use VRs, ARs, you use this camera stuff. My 15 years ago, the most expensive 3D print is today so cheap. Like there are also, you know, they are printing even food and materials like in different levels. So also these robotic arms, like one of my ex-colleagues, Suryansh and Mustafa, I guess more or less the same time when I decided to quit Zaha, they also opened their own office, and they didn't choose the same kind of path like me, but they took another risk, and they really started their own company to develop this robotic arm to be able to, you know, feed the architecture from a different perspective. And the way how they are developing this thing, or there are many other also architects, designers, and engineers working on this kind of stuff. Actually, these things will also come into our office, not only, you know, in a very specific lab that you can enter or not enter, and they are, then they will open a different era for all of us to really develop design in a different way. The 3D printer that I have right now in my office, unfortunately, I am still using it the way exactly how I was using it 15 years ago. It's just a tool to represent the end result. But we need to find ways of integrating them really to develop the design approach, not just as a perfect, nice, representing 3D model, in my opinion. And there are also drones. There are many ways of using these drones, but especially in construction, because I followed them, like how they are used, because here on the left side, you see some part from our TV tower project. The maintenance thing, at some part, if it's reachable area, they are using, you know, the old techniques, and at the end of the day, they put the cranes on the top on 203 meter level high, these two cranes to be able to 360 to have the maintenance for the tower. But I was always against it, because when we had to take the decision to put the cranes, it was around 2016, and we had to put it, how can I say, like legally in the list for the construction. And I was telling them, but the technology is developing so fast that like, you won't need it when this building is finished. And but they were saying they had to put it. And now there are these two cranes, I will show you later on. They are standing there, but I believe in 5 years' time, we won't need them, because there are these drones, they are already doing certain maintenance jobs. Like, there are companies who opened, drone companies for the facade maintenance, and they are using them for this kind of. And this is one of our cultural center project. We worked on this, and this will start soon if we pass by the economical crisis in Turkey. And here, what I want to shortly just talk about, when you design your architectural building, usually the way how the design process starts, we always design this thin shell which covers the spaces and stuff, but this is just for the concept part of the project. But as an architect, you need to really have the knowledge about the facade build-up. Like if your project is going to be really built, you need to have the knowledge about this. Usually they are differentiated according to 50 centimeter or 1 meter, but you need to have the knowledge about how to develop this knowledge, and because in this kind of complex geometries, if you want to deal with the complexity, you need to, in my opinion, if you start with the simple rules, you can always get the best complexity, because you have certain knowledge how to control them, and then you let them grow their complexity. So for this building, we used just six looping curves, and we were able to, you know, in this BIM world, we were able to, from Rhino to Revit, to really control the facade system, like when the, because I was also in Turkey, not in London. There are like this kind of facts that we should never forget, like where you are, the economical level of the country, the cultural level, the educational level are affecting the way how you also do architecture. I might know how to build it, but they, if they don't know how to do it, then things are changing. And the power of, as an architect, you have are sometimes, I mean, most of the time are so limited according to the way how they are, they have the control on the system. And just one very small, what was, this is one of our, again, like very small scale furniture design, but it is adaptive and it is changing. It's, I mean, according to the way how the person who want to use it and buy it according to their house conditions, they can give us certain parameters. I mean, the way how we were also seeing today, according to certain, you know, stuff, like you can really define them. I mean, it's very simple thing, but you can apply this into anything, and it's always easy for us, especially if you're a young office, to start from small scale and develop ideas into big scale. Because for me, these are the testing backgrounds to be able to test here and then to develop these ideas into bigger projects or bigger organizational systems. And finally, I will start talking about this Istanbul TV and Radio Tower project. Actually, sorry for the Turkish part, but the story of this project is actually goes back to almost 2011. There was an idea competition in Istanbul about this TV and radio tower project back then. The government opened this competition in Istanbul, and this is a view from the tower right now, I mean, not right now, but currently. They wanted to remove all these antennas, which are right now on the next hill, it's called Çamlıca Hill, because they were, how do you say, like they were aggregating in time, like without any illegal ways somehow. They were so they wanted to really put all those systems in one tower, one TV and radio tower project. So we entered to this project, and at the end of 2013, the government decided to move on with this idea of design and develop this project. So this is one of the first renders we did when we start developing the project. It is located on Küçük Çamlıca Hill, it's called. It's one of Istanbul has seven hills, and this is one of that hills. It's important. It's on the Asia side of Istanbul, in the main axis of the Bosporus Bridge. The design idea actually developed, I mean, for me, this, to enter this competition, first of all, it was important for me because I was very excited always developing the negotiation between architecture and infrastructure and structure. This was really one of my interested things in architecture when I really start doing my professional jobs at Zaha Hadid Architects, to discover the world, like how we can combine really the engineering knowledge with architecture knowledge. And this kind of project, this is 369 meter high. And usually these TV and radio tower projects in Europe, mainly they were done maybe mid of 1950s, 1960s, there were lots of them. And in my opinion, for Istanbul, this was a late project. Actually, there was one on the hill that I showed you, but it was not in the right programmatic scale. That's why there were a lot of other antennas next to it. And anyhow, so these kind of projects, usually they are known the masterpieces of structural engineers. Like usually they are known like this. For me, that's why it was interesting to really, if we can find a way to combine the power of architect and engineering together, because when you let this be designed by an engineer, they do this conic shape because they need to go high, and for them the best shape in structural design is to have the conic shape, and then if the client needs in their brief certain programs, put the sphere on it, and another one, how many they need, they put so many spheres because it's they know how to do it the best, like that's why they prefer using it this way. So for this project, we started from that point, actually, like having again like the same, because the brief was very clear where the programs will be and these kind of things were quite clear, putting these things, but getting also information from nature, because the wind was really important in that hill. And even right now, like when there is no tower, you go there 220 meter high from the sea level, the wind force has been always very important, and we thought we can take maybe two important parameters. One of them could be the wind, and the second one can be the view angles to give shape to this structure. So the formations of the facade are taking their information from the wind conditions plus the view angles towards Asia and Europe. There are two faces of the tower, and the way how it communicates with the ground level is actually it takes the information from the topographical existence to create space under the hill itself, in a way, like in indirectly way we were trying to do that. There are these some first sketches how we were trying to develop certain things in the project. And there are 13 levels, habitable spaces on between 200 meter and 150 meter, and only four of them are open to the public. The other nine floors are for technical services for the steel antenna, which is around 155 meter high, and it's on top of, I mean, here in this image you don't see. And on the base, on the podium part, it was important to really make this kind of part of this landscape itself. And so when you enter to the park, this pathway leads you actually into three scenarios. And one of them is you take the path and you walk here, and it takes you to this plaza. I mean, it's not big because you are in the forest. Actually, this area I forgot to mention, maybe this is a forest area. It's in the middle of the forest, on top of the hill, but it's surrounded with the forest. And here you have a view towards the Princess Islands. If I mean, some of you already may know, the Princess Islands is in your view angle. And there is another path. If you walk on the roof, it takes you another journey here, because each of them are will give us a different experience. And there are two panoramic elevators in the tower. So these panoramic elevators are dividing the form in a way in two faces, which one of them is facing the Asia. We call it Asia, really the face of Asia, and the other one is Europe. And hopefully next, I mean, at the end of this year, if everything goes well, or beginning of next year, when we enter the foyer area, we will face this. And this is a corridor which takes us to the panoramic elevators. And on top, there are, as I mentioned, there are these four floors. Two of them are restaurant levels, and two of them are the observation levels. There are not many square meters, but they are good enough to give the people, public, the opportunity to see Istanbul from 108 meter, I mean, from 180 meters of tower, but actually from sea level when you calculate it's 400 meters. In Istanbul, usually, there are some high-rise buildings, but they are private buildings, so people, they don't really have this opportunity. I believe that this will give another chance to public to really question the future of the city. And it's some small videos from this is kind of a technical movie, but in a way we were trying to scan the scan the facade and the tectonics of this, because it's a TV and radio tower. And I leave you. Which are made to give this shape. You'll see, this one is a bit long, maybe I take you to other movie because it is shorter. I can explain better there. Sorry, you might see some scenes again, but. So there are more than 50 levels in the tower until this antenna part starts. And as you see here, when we take the scan of the plans, like each level is different because the shape of the building provides that. And what I was going to say, everything is elliptical. There is a core, a concrete core in the middle of the tower. It is around 12 by 16 meter wide. It's elliptical shape, so the whole floors are shaped more or less elliptically. In this project, there were more than 26 different engineers and consultants. They took part in the design development and construction process to be able to make this building happen. And one of the most difficult things regarding, since this was a really tall infrastructural project, it's not like you design a high-rise building. The challenging thing is because everyone is developing things either inside that core or around it, and they have to do everything at the same time. Like every decision had to be taken at the same time. If not, if you leave it to structural engineers, they want to make it wider and fatter and fatter and fatter, and you want to keep it slimmer as much as possible. And of course, this thing needs a certain understanding regarding the way how I call it, the horizontal hierarchy. Like you need to really develop things in this kind of structure with all the engineers and client all together to agree certain things together. And here is another scan of the building. Here you see actually in the middle the concrete core and the steel structure around it, and some facade exploded. Because here actually this is in a way a superposed diagram of these BIM tools that we were using. Like at the same time, there is certain things from Rhino, from structural engineers, from the Revit, all of them together, and they were all feeding each other. And this is an image from our wind tunnel test. For me, it was really important because it was my first time I went to Canada. There is a firm called RWDI, and they are doing this big wind tunnel test for high rise. You might know them. And to see they are really this, how intelligent they put inside such a model, and the way how they they printed special elastic material for the that black thing you see there, and there were at least 10 different models like this in different scales, and some of them were full height, some of them were not. And for us, this was really important, this test, because wind power was the main thing which also shaped not only architecture, the structure, and also facade buildup all together. According to results we got from there, we gave the final shape to everything. And here you see also more again from the digital project management part, architectural model, structural model, facade model, everything. We had to do, of course, some special programming regarding this to design the tiling between these 2,500 panels. Even though they are vertical and they are only in one direction, but there are so many opportunities, and in some of, I mean, you need to really design them, and yeah, we tried many iterations. Another way of looking at this. And during the design process, we were also doing the mock-ups of the facade, but still we were in the design process, not construction yet. We wanted to make sure that this, the facade is single curved, it's not double curved. It was a decision which I made really during the competition process, because I knew that we are in Turkey, and I learned how we can really build double curved facade. I mean, it is possible, you can make it, but if you really take, sometimes you really need to negotiate also with your architectural ambition, certain things. And I believe that if we make this single, that's why the facade is not smoothly going. There are these steps, and but in city scale, actually you see it still like as a smooth formal architectural iteration. But when you zoom into the building, you see all these extruded facade slices. And because in Turkey, I mean, it is still experimental for them, this thing, to make it really for 200 meters long, all these things, and all of them need their own mold, because they are all have different angles and stuff. Anyway, this was made in Mexico, the mock-ups. We were hoping that they will get the job, but unfortunately, maybe fortunately, from Turkey, a company they got, and they are learning now how to deal with these things, you know, develop their skills. And because, I have to say it, the way how we propose all the details for the facade, first that company said, no, we cannot do it. I said, we can do it. We made it in the past. Like, it is possible, but they, at the end, they agreed after they tried their first mock-up, and then I guess now they got their own patent and stuff, like to really use that details in their book. This is from last week, this picture. Actually, Ege, where is Ege? He's now phase one in DRL, and he was also my student from Istanbul Bilgi University. He's taking photos of our project from the construction phase. All these pictures are from him. And for me, one of the interesting parts is also this part, because in this kind of infrastructural projects, the construction process is, in my opinion, as important as the life cycle of the building starts. Because we designed this building for 100 years lifetime, but almost 4 years or 5 years of this lifetime is the construction part. And here it is not a static, it's not the same way as all the other high-rise building is designed, because you'll see soon. This is a diagram from the competition process. Competition design. I was proposing back then that the way how we can build up the levels of the building is actually first you use this what was it called? The slip form, and you build up the concrete shell, and afterwards you the steel structure, you build up the levels above, but you build them up down, and then you lift them up, up, I couldn't say, up. And more or less, almost 80% of these ideas are used currently, and you'll see them. And another, like, this is from now, like, this is how this is happening. Like, first we build up the basement levels, and after basement levels, the concrete, and then the transition, and then the antenna we build up inside the concrete, and level by level. And here you see the timeline of this construction process. It started around 2016, and it still continues. Hopefully, at the end of this year, it will finish. So we have 21 meter deep basement levels, and then we have 203 meter tall this concrete core. We have the transition zone. Afterwards, we started building this 145 meter tall steel antenna, but we divided them into segments, like 12 segments. We opened a door next to the here you can see to the concrete. So we were taking first from the top part, taking inside, lifting up, and then taking the other one, lifting up, and then connecting them. So we build up this whole thing inside the core. We didn't build in the middle. Actually, there is this fire staircase. Because of this methodology, we didn't build it yet. We just started. So then we lifted up from inside of the tower up this steel antenna. And later on, this exciting process for me started, because until then, in Istanbul, people were saying really horrible things about this, because they were seeing just this core, and they didn't, if you are not an architect, you didn't really, you know, what is that? Just extruded, you see just a concrete something in the middle of the city. And recently they start understanding what's going on, and everyone is getting excited, and they are following every 2 months. It takes 2 months to lift, build 3-4 levels on the ground, and then it takes only the first one took 5 days to really move it up. The second one third, like it's getting less and less. And it became an action for the also city. Like, if people are really following this project, they wait for 2 months and then they follow during these 3-4 days what's happening, if it's moving up. Hopefully, at the end of, in March, we will see this view. Like, because right now we are around here. You'll see from the movies also, I will show you. And in next 2 months, they will build up these last 3 floors. And then the other part will be faster, because there are not habitable spaces. It's more to continue the shape of the facade we have. Now I would like to share with you some pictures from the construction, like real photos, and some time-lapse movies to give you more understanding about the process. This is from the when we first digged in 21 meter and start doing the basement. This is a typical thing, but here at least you can see the traces of the core, like if you see, and there is a man here. We have each level is 4.5 meter in our tower. These are the moments when this 145 meter tall steel antenna was reaching the sky. It was the first photo. Because in this space, I couldn't go. They didn't let me in, because it was dangerous to go there. And the engineers were sharing these pictures, and they were sending me, okay, now it's going up, it's reaching the sky. I'm like, okay. And these are pictures again. Ege took these pictures from the first lifting up. This was so exciting process for us because the construction firm, the contractor actually, okay, everything theoretically was working, but we didn't know if it's gonna really work. but they managed, because this thing you see here, this was 1,000 tons, like 1 million kilos, I don't know, like 10,000 cars. Like you can, if you start comparing like this, then you see, okay, it's not like as easy as you draw, you know, in the computer, but it is really happening. And each time when I was going on site, we could hear the sound of the, here you see maybe the cables, like there are 12 machines here around this zone, like all around the elliptical plan. So they are distributed evenly, and the steel ropes are going down to, actually, in my opinion, it's very old school thing. Like you, like when you think about it, like there are these ropes going down and they are lifting up the slabs, the building. But in a way, when you multiply this with all the difficulties you have here, it becomes something really important. And like the structure is in motion, there is wind conditions, there are these ropes are making such a sound when you are there, you feel the power, like the real power, you understand. It's interesting. This was again from the, we call it K1, like each phase we call, because it comes from Turkish, actually lifting one normally, it's in Turkish, it's kaldırma bir, kaldırma iki, kaldırma, like lifting one, lifting two. But it became a code in a way. This is K1 when it's moving up. It was maybe its third day on the way up, and from Istanbul you see all these antennas will be removed after the building finished. This is when they were building that K1, like the steel structure, and then they are putting the all the slabs and the facade cladding plus the GRC, and then they are putting all the mechanical, how do you call it? Services, let's say, yeah. And also facade lighting, they had to put everything, like as it's finished, and they are painting and everything, it's finished, and then it starts its journey, it goes. And I wasn't in Istanbul that time. When it starts moving up 10 centimeters, they called me from the site. They were saying, we managed. They were sending me the picture of that moment, because for them, if it moves 10 centimeters, it can move 200 meters. It's the same thing. So it was a moment, like everyone was, okay, managed. And directly they start underneath for the second lifting up, like construction. And I guess in this movie there is also another, I mean, sorry for the movies, we will have better ones, but these are from the ones I got for now. This is K2, like the lifting up too. It also goes up. This was heavier, this was 1,200, I guess. Yeah, around 1,200 tons they lifted up. The restaurant table was inside. And these are images recently taken just before New Year. From here you see K2. Here K3 is going up, the lifting up tree. And here we say in Turkish, they kissed each other, like they come together. In Turkish it's something like that. And here I would like to also show you with this surrounding of the city, some one last video from the construction process. I turned off the sound because it's not my style. Sorry. It's their style. Hopefully we will also prepare our own soon. Here you see on the top there you were seeing K1 and K2, and now the K1, K2 together here. This one will be the restaurant level. Here, we will put the GRCs later here. Right now we cannot, because we have these machines, the 12 machines who are doing actually the main job for the tower. Later on they will put, they will clad this part. There are one panoramic elevator is here, and the other one is on the other side. All these antennas will be removed from the tower. And there is, I think, one more. This is a little bit bad quality, sorry about it. And here K3 actually, they came together. This is because they couldn't send me the final video, that's why I had to take this one. Here you see K3 and K2 together, all of them. There will be certain maintenance things still needs to be done for these panels here. Oh, sorry, what? Sorry, the mouse. How can I, anyway. Here I don't see the slider, but yeah. Okay, so hopefully when it's finished, oops, too much sound. I mean, it will look more or less something like this. And this was again from before we start doing the K3. This was one of the inspiring images for me to really, it is such a tall building. And of course, like this, the nature also sometimes really creates these inspirational moments for us that it exists in the sky, but it disappears and then it exists. And in many ways, like every day, there is a different tower actually we see and we will see. So thank you very much. Yeah, I mean, if there are any, yes. If not, we can have drinks.
Please ask Malika, otherwise go home and come back. Please ask.
If there are any, yeah. No, actually, I teach only part-time. I mean, I'm running my practice. I mean, that's the main target. From time to time, I do the part-time teaching in Istanbul, depending on the semester and stuff. We are around 10, 12, depends, like, between 8 and 12, it's changing the scale of the office, like, people are working with me in my team. And we are a young office, like developing things as much as possible in the circumstances we have in Istanbul. But in a way, I believe that our address is Istanbul, but you know, the world is also such a, in a way, so small that everyone is connected to each other. And yeah. I try my best to do that because it's really important, because the discussion there is totally different than what we have here, really totally different. And I try my best. The way how I call it, I mean, we are trying to change them. That's what I'm trying to do, because they need to also implement these ideas into architecture and for the future of architecture. There are certain discussions actually just started, what we were discussing maybe 10 years, 15 years ago. Like, there is a gap, there is a big gap, but there are a lot of friends of mine who are also from London, from AA, they went back to Istanbul, and we are all together in a way trying to combine forces for a, you know, better future actually. That's what I can say.
Thank you for the answer. Could you explain a bit more about this moment when Istanbul was calling you? What was the moment? At what point you decided to move, like, from
to go back to Istanbul? I mean, it is very difficult to really explain the main reason, but in a way, either really, I had two options for me. Like, everyone has different career stuff. Either I was going to stay with Zahid because I was really happy, and I always say that Patrick is one of the persons that I met in my life. I mean, you are special, that's for sure. I didn't meet someone like you until now, like, who had so many... anyway, it's difficult to describe it, but yeah. It is... because sometimes the nationality, and how can I describe it, like, your homeland calls you in a way, like your family, like not a emotional way I'm trying to describe it, but for me, when I really decided to take this decision, I really saw the future in somehow. Okay, my address can be Istanbul, but it's a small world and everyone is connected, like digitally or physically. Everything is so easy right now. We can connect each other. And so, and to share the knowledge I had there, for me, was another thing. Maybe I'm not a nationalist person, but sometimes, you know, these things come out and you want to really also educate people there, not only, you know, here for developing things, also educating certain, I mean, sharing knowledges there is different. I think these were some key points affected me to go back, and I shouldn't say go back, but, you know, to establish in Istanbul.
You started there, did you have a regulation commission?
No, I didn't have. I went there, no, I didn't have any commission back. I mean, my first commission I got 1 year after I opened my practice. It was this project, but it was 1 year after, and it was not certain. My decision was not related at all to this project. It was really the decision. I said, I'm going to go back and take the risk, like start. Start something. However it develops, we will see. And yeah, I hope I answered
you. You mentioned, as we know in Turkey, these ideas are so kind of like alien. When I talk to my friends, I do understand how they look at this kind of architecture. And I just want to know, do you think there is a platform that you want to spread these ideas in Turkey,
yes,
in Istanbul?
As much as we build, we can spread, I think.
Do you want to go with this, just like take these commissions, which is going to be really rare and really good opportunity to kind of spread these ideas, but these are really rare, and you think this could be a progression?
I think there will be, because as much as we build, I mean, not only me, like there are a lot of friends of mine, they are also dealing with this kind of architectural problems, like the way, you know, what we are trying to do here, they are trying to implement there. As much as we build, you know, the discourse also will change, and you need to have the opportunity to discuss it and also to be stubborn on it, like, because they are so powerful to, you know, kill the discourse, but you need to stand there and really show them the good side of this, because for me, there are, I mean, these kind of projects, I mean, not because of its toll, like the way the knowledge it has inside, using all these, you know, in a way, tools and all these coordination things, all these collaborations, and this is a culture, like it's a certain way of doing. You can do this in a small scale for a pavilion or for a tower, doesn't matter for me, like it's the way of understanding for the architecture, and you need to, you know, just show the opportunities and argue with it wherever, I mean, wherever I go, I just try to, you know, stand there behind what we believe in, because the future is there. So maybe they see it or they don't see it, or there are certain things they want to just, you know, ignore, not only for Turkey, for many countries all over the world. There are these conservative, of course, approach. But respect to everyone.
I think we should leave it there.
Yes.